Hello, everybody. This is James Lawrence again, and I want to talk to you about the Antichrist. Is there really going to be like a person, an entity that is human-like, really that does look like a human being, who will appear in the end times? Will there be an actual Antichrist who will be a person, the personified anti-Christian human being who is against Christ and all that is holy, against God himself, the Antichrist who will come in the end times? Yes, yes is the answer to that. Okay, now I wanted to directly get into the scriptures so I can keep this a little over devotional length but not lengthy. That way you can enjoy this and receive something from the Word of God that I believe will be inspiring to you. I don't always teach on inspirational, but what I meant to say is sensationalistic type things, although you can barely get away from that no matter what you're talking about. If you're talking about the crucifixion of the Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, shedding his blood for the remission of our sins, and after dying on that cross, shedding his blood, he went to a tomb in death, but he was raised again from the dead 3 days later, as the Bible puts it, raised again. So it just simply really means that he rose from the grave. Okay, so yes, Jesus is Lord, and what all I just spoke to you about what he did for us is the gospel. It's the good news. To me, that's very sensational. And it's the greatest doctrine in the Holy Bible. Without it, folks, our studying of all of the things would mean nothing. I mean, there would be nothing that would be important to us to even learn in the Bible, in the Holy Scriptures, the Holy Bible, if it wasn't for Jesus Christ, him crucified and being our Savior when we receive him and become born again, as it's called. Because the Bible says that God recreates in us a new spirit. Now, some people say that sounds like a strange type of thing. Well, regardless of that, that's what he does. Behold, all things become new. Old things pass away. Behold, all things become new. But that's in here. Our physical body, you look in the mirror, you're the same person. Because this sinful flesh will have to be resurrected, which I will talk about here in a moment. But let me talk about this thing about the Antichrist. Let me set this up first by reading some scripture, end time Bible prophecy scriptures. Matthew chapter 24. And I'll read verse 4 through 8, because the disciples were in, they were wanting to know, in other words, from Jesus, when shall the end of these things be? When is the end coming? You know, they were inquisitive about that on more than one occasion. And in this occasion, Jesus said this. Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilences, and earthquakes in divers places. All these are the beginning of sorrows. Now, divers meaning diverse, we say nowadays, meaning in a variety of places these earthquakes will happen. Now, he said all these are the beginning of sorrows. Jesus goes on to say that people will have much less love for each other. He says that the love of many shall wax cold. It will harden like wax and become cold. Okay, so people will not, they'll be without natural affection, another scripture talks about. Without natural affection. You don't love your brother and sister anymore. You don't love your fellow human being at all. You pretty much hate people and you want to see bad things for them because your life's not too pleasant, so why not have theirs to be? And if not, if they're not, maybe you can make them miserable somehow. You know, that's how people really think. But Jesus went on to say that people within their own household would hate each other. and they would even bring each other up to be put to death. He then talked about Israel and said that they'd be hated of all nations for his sake. Now, you drop down to verses 21 through 31, which, no, I'm just doing, let me see which one I got here. Okay, this must be chapter 24, verse 21. So I've dropped down from verses 4 through 8 down to verse 21. So leading into the rest of these sorrows that will occur, he then says, "For then shall be great tribulation," much worse than the beginning of sorrows. "For then shall be great tribulation, as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, no, nor ever shall be." Okay, we know from many scriptures that the Antichrist system is then implemented in the world, okay? Because he said, then there shall be great tribulation. Well, the great tribulation largely has to do with the Antichrist system and the devil being very angry, knowing he has but a short time. It says it in the scriptures. Okay, now I'm paraphrasing slightly, just very slightly. And it says he comes down having great wrath, knowing he has but a short time. So he uses this man to deceive the world, to enter a peace treaty with Israel, but to break that in half. So it's a 7-year period of tribulation. 7 years is a number of completeness with God. And so in the middle of that 7-year period, at 3.5 years, he breaks that covenant with Israel, and then you talk about truly hell breaking loose. It will break loose on that nation specifically, and across the world as well. But man, will Israel be persecuted after being hated of all nations for all those years leading up to this Antichrist appearance. Okay, so it says in 1 John chapter 2, verse 18, "Little children, it is the last time." In other words, it's the end times. They believed it even then, 2,000 years ago, because it was. "A day with the Lord is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is as a day." So to God, it's as if 2 days have passed, if that's how he looks at it. It depends on what he wants to do. He can look at things how he wants to look at them. But he said, "Little children, it is the last time. And as ye have heard that Antichrist shall come, even now are there many Antichrists, whereby ye know that it is the last time." So Satan began implementing his plan of trying to deceive as many people as he can out of receiving the true gospel of Christ through these false Christs. So it started even then, and that's how John, as he wrote in this first epistle here that he wrote in chapter 2, he said that Antichrist shall come. He's specifying a certain Antichrist, but then he says, even now are there many, many Antichrists. Okay? He didn't say many, many. I kind of had to repeat the word. There are many Antichrists, whereby you know that it's the last time. Now, let me read one about the Antichrist appearance, which is very interesting. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 7 and 8, "For the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who now letteth will let, until he be taken out of the way, and then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming." This is referring to the Antichrist. It says the mystery of iniquity is that there's someone who is not letting his appearance. He will only not let him appear for a certain amount of time. Now, this is what it's saying. Only he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. Okay, so when he's taken out of the way, who is that talking about? Well, first of all, before I answer that question, you know, in Revelation, it even talks about at the Battle of Armageddon, when the Antichrist and his armies come to try to destroy Israel again, and tries to... Now, let me just say this. Israel has been destroyed to an extent. Never, you know, cast down, but not destroyed. I guess you could say that. But they were taken over by Babylonian, imprisonment with the Babylonians for a period of time. Even after Jesus said the things he did about the one stone not being left upon another in Matthew 24, talking about the temples in Israel, in Jerusalem, and saying they will be cast down. And this happened in 70 AD. So there are things that happened not long after Jesus said some of these things, but he goes on to say that in the end times, these things will happen, and about the earthquakes and famines and so forth. So who is this that is allowed to be released on the earth after a certain one is taken out of the way? Okay, this is referring, of course, to the Antichrist appearing only after someone is removed. Who is that someone? Well, let me just tell you this. It is really the church. It is a group of people, hopefully around the world, that are number many people. Let's hope that. I do. And, you know, it says this about those people. Because God, the Holy Spirit, cannot be taken out of the way. And the reason being, this is the reason. Colossians chapter 1, verse beginning with verse 16. Was that two verses I read? Anyway, beginning with verse 16, it says, "For by him were all things created." Talking about God and the Spirit of God, and of course the Son of God, Son, God the Son, who is at the right hand of the Father. They are one God, the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. The church has known this for thousands of years. Okay, so all things were created by him that are in heaven, that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by him and for him. For he is before all things, and by him all things consist. Okay? It's like consist is a word that means that they continue and they are held together. You know, if the Holy Spirit was literally removed from the earth would implode into itself. It would disintegrate. Because the Holy Spirit he's omnipresent. I mean, God, you can say God is omnipresent. Even the presence of Jesus and the Father. And that's all through the Holy Spirit that he manifests in our hearts. And it's a hard thing to understand. It's the Trinity. We won't understand it in this lifetime, but we know that that's what the Bible says he is. It talks about God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost, and that he is one God who manifests in these three persons of the Godhead, and he is called the Godhead. Okay, so he can't be taken out of the way, so it is the church. And one thing about the church being taken out of the way is that we are the salt of the earth. Jesus called us that, Christian people who believe in him. We are the light of the world. So the world is in darkness, but we bring light to it. When that salt, the preserving force, and the light is taken off the earth, then darkness and non-preservation of our societies, which it's already going downhill, but that's the beginning of sorrows. Okay, that Jesus talked about in the one that I talked about earlier, which included, you know, about kingdoms going against each other and famines and pestilences and earthquakes and so forth. They are the beginning of sorrows. For then shall be great tribulation, he said, that will be like nothing that has ever happened, yeah, not since the beginning of the world to this time, no, nor ever shall be. So he's talking about that future event called the Great Tribulation. So down here, who is it that's taken out of the way so that the Antichrist system can begin happening? 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16 and 17. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we, which are alive and remain, who are also in Christ, trust me, this is what it's saying, that we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. So the church is also called the body of Christ in the scriptures, and we are anointed by the Holy Spirit. The unsaved are not. Okay? Now, can they be influenced by the Holy Spirit toward salvation? Yes, and God does that. But are they anointed as are people who are in Christ? In other words, they're born again. The Bible says, all things pass away. Behold, all things become new. It says that about Christians, and it's the spirit man. It's not the body. It's corruptible. We can still sin, but we are supposed to definitely resist sin with all of our might, the best that we possibly can. If a sin does overtake us, like John said in one of his epistles, I was just talking about 1 John, that may be it. He says, brethren, I write to you that you sin not, but if any man sin, now he's talking to a church, see? He said, but if any man sin, we have a propitiation for sin, and that is Jesus Christ, the righteous. And he can cleanse us from all sin. He goes on to say, he who says he has no sin. Now, I'm talking present tense. First, it says he who says he has not sinned. In other words, I've never sinned in my past. That's a lie. The other lie is he who says, see, he who says he has not sinned is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But if we confess our sins, now if I paraphrase some there, but if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So Jesus is the propitiation, as he said at that first part of that scripture passage of I write to you that you sin not, but if any man sins, we have a propitiation, and that is Jesus Christ, the righteous, who takes our place, and he advocates for us. He's our high priest as well. And the scripture says that about him and about him being our advocate. So we have a wonderful Lord who goes to bat for us and helps us to receive forgiveness from God by pleading for us. Now you say, are you sure about that, James Lawrence? Well, the Bible says that we are of the body of Christ. Of course Jesus goes to bat for his own body. Now we are his body and members in particular. The Bible talks about some being an eye, some being an ear, some being a hand, and some being a foot to demonstrate that we are of the body. Okay? And that one part of the body shouldn't say to the other, you're not of the body because you're not the ear like I am. Okay, now I kind of quickly went through that and paraphrased it, but that is what one of the scriptures say. So the one who will be taken away out of the earth so that the wicked one can reveal himself, the Antichrist who will claim to be God, and he will sit in the temple claiming that he is God, and that is the abomination of desolation that Daniel the prophet spoke of. And the New Testament brings that into there, and they said, remember what Daniel, he who readeth, let him understand. You know, that Daniel the prophet said that the abomination of desolation. So the Antichrist shall actually claim to be God and set himself up in the temple of God, saying that he is God. And the scriptures do say that, I promise you. I do paraphrase some things, but I'm giving you the meaning. I'm not taking away or adding to the meaning of these scriptures that I refer to, but that I don't quote outrightly like I did these other five that I read passages and scriptures, you know, single scriptures that I read to you. So there is a real Antichrist, and he is coming, folks, and the Bible says to stay ready and to beware of false Christ that shall come and say, lo, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. Now, do some of them actually say, I'm Christ, or do they have all of what they think are the attributes of being a Christ? I think the latter is true. They may not just say, I am a Christ, but they definitely do false prophecies and false healings. Does that sound familiar? And things like that. So folks, do beware of the fact that we are in the end times, and we must stay in Christ, praying and fervently worshiping God through him, okay, and blessing God with the actions of our life and the fruits of the Spirit that reach other people. for Jesus Christ and witnessing to them also the Word of God. Thank you for hearing. God bless you. I'll talk to you again soon. James Lawrence saying goodbye for now.